This video was brought to you by GeneralPack.com, making power systems intuitive, open, and free to everyone, everywhere. Consider subscribing and supporting through patreon.com/GeneralPack. This is the mechanism for you to support us financially so we can continue making high-quality power system video tutorials. Our corporate sponsor for this topic is AllumiaX.com from Seattle, Washington. Contact them for industrial and commercial power system studies. Why we use per unit systems, part 2e, elimination of the square root of 3 from three-phase calculations. In this video, we will demonstrate the fourth and final advantage of using per unit systems in power system calculations. Let's start with the basics. In order to perform power system analysis of three-phase systems, we have to perform per-phase and line-to-line conversions that involve a factor of square root of 3. There are formulas to achieve this, but it is quite prone to errors and miscalculations due to an irrational number being present, i.e. the square root of 3. Also, the square root of 3 factor can be annoying and an eyesore in hand calculations. However, when the impedances, voltages, and currents in three-phase systems are transformed into per unit equivalents, the need of complex calculations is eliminated. The use of square root of 3 is reduced to one or two steps. And to polish this idea, let's solve an example from a book of electric power systems by B.M. Weedy, 5th edition. Example 2.5 shows a schematic diagram of a radial transmission system, and the problem statement states that the ratings of the reactances of various components are shown in the diagram. A load of 50 megawatts at 0.8 power factor lagging, it's lagging again, is taken from a 33 kV substation, which is to be maintained at 30 kV. It is required to calculate the terminal voltage of the synchronous machines. The line and a transformer may be represented by series reactances, and this is a three-phase system. So now we have to calculate VS, that is the voltage being supplied by the machines to the entire power system. Let's now analyze the system. We are given two transformers, which means we have to calculate their impedances. There is a transmission line, we have to calculate the impedance offered by the transmission line, and then there is a load that has to be maintained on a specific voltage. The first step is to identify the base power. Since both the transformer have apparent power of 50 MVA, we'll choose this as our base power for the whole system. Now there is one new thing that is to be seen with this example. There is something marked as X under the two transformer. This X is the reactance of the transformer that is shown in percentage. We take this percentage as per unit value of the reactances offered by the component in the power system. So we conclude that the reactance offered in per unit by transformer 1 and transformer 2 are J0.1 per unit and J0.12 per unit respectively. Since we know the per unit impedances of the transformer, we can now calculate the per unit impedances of the transmission line. For the base impedance of the transmission line, it's very simple. The base impedance is equal to the voltage impedance of the transmission line squared divided by the base power of the transmission line. The base voltage being 132 kV squared divided by 50 MVA, and that equals 348.5 ohms. After that, we simply calculate the per unit impedance of the transmission line, which is simply equal to the actual impedance of the transmission line divided by the base. The actual impedance being J100 ohms, the base being 348.5 ohms that we calculated earlier, which gives us a value of J0.287 per unit. So the series impedance of the power system will be the sum of all the impedances calculated, meaning Z total is equal to the transformer impedance in per unit plus the transformer 2 impedance in per unit plus the transmission line impedance of per unit, and that is equal to J0.1 plus J0.12 plus J0.287, which gives us a total impedance of J0.507 per unit. Next, we will determine the current that should be flowing in our power system and into the load if the load has to be maintained at 30 kV. We have derived formulas that relate to the base power and the base voltage in part 1d of this series, and the formula is very simple. The apparent power is equal to the square root of 3 times the voltage times the current. Now this formula is only for unity power factor. We will rearrange this formula and calculate the current flowing through the load and add the power factor correction into the equation. So the current is equal to the apparent power divided by the square root of 3 times the voltage times the power factor. The apparent power being 50 MVA divided by the square root of 3 times 30 kV times 0.8 power factor, which gives us a current value of 1203 amps. The cosine angle or power factor is added because the load is operating at a power factor that leads us to a value of 203 amps at the angle of negative 36.86 degrees. We have a negative angle because the current lags the voltage by 36.86 degrees. If the current was leading the voltage, then the angle would be a positive. But since it's lagging, it's a negative angle. We will now calculate the base current in the power system and the load. The base current being the base power divided by the square root of 3 times the voltage base, which equals 50 MVA divided by the square root of 3 times 33 kV, gives us 874.8 amps. Calculating the per unit value of the current is simply equals to the actual current value divided by the base current value. That is equal to 1203 amps at the angle of negative 36.86 degrees divided by 874.8 amps gives us 1.375 per unit at the angle of negative 36.86 per unit. Calculating the per unit voltage at the load is equal to simply actual voltage at the load divided by the base voltage of the load. The actual voltage being 30 kV, the base voltage being 33 kV gives us 0.91 per unit. Now we apply Kirchhoff's law and calculate the total voltage at the source in per unit, which is equal to the current in per unit times the total impedance in per unit plus the voltage at the load of in per unit. However, again, we also need to take into account of the lagging power factor 0.80. According to the problem statement, the current lags the voltage by a power factor of 0.80, which means the current lags voltage by 36.86 degrees. So the voltage in per unit simply equals 1.375 per unit at the angle of negative 36.86 degrees, that's the current, multiplied by the total impedance, which equals J.507 per unit, and then we add 0.91 per unit as the voltage at the load, and that gives us a total value of 1.44 per unit at the angle of 22.79 degrees. So we have the per unit values of the terminal voltage, and we know the formula to calculate the actual voltage at the generating source. So the voltage at the generating source is simply equals the actual voltage of the source divided by the base voltage of the source. Rearranging the equation, we could simply calculate the voltage of the source is equal to the per unit voltage times the base voltage. The base voltage at the generating source is 11 kV. That is the primary voltage of transformer 1. So we can ignore the angle, resulting in 1.44 per unit times 11 kV. So the voltage at the source is simply equal to 15.84 kV. Finally, we have solved the example using a very easy method of per unit calculations. Notice that we do not use the square root of 3 once we convert the system into per unit equivalent. It was just used in two steps to calculate the base values. Therefore, if we want to analyze three-phase systems, we could simply calculate the per unit values and eliminate the need of square root of 3. Now, this video concludes the second part of the series in power system analysis. In this part, we saw the four major advantages of using per unit systems in the analysis of power systems. One thing that we should notice here is that all of the calculations were manual processes. We would solve these examples using pen and paper, and we were sure that per unit calculations make our work easy. Just imagine if per unit calculations can reduce our time and effort while doing them by hand. What effect would it have on machines? We can conveniently claim that if we use computational methods, the significance of per unit systems will increase, meaning that if we use per unit systems in computational methods, it will be much faster and much more efficient using machines. In the next part, we will perform some further derivation and solve more complex problems. We hope you have a continued interest in this topic and series as a student or professional. We also hope that you find this content useful and enlightening. Please consider subscribing to generalpack.com and becoming our patron at patreon.com/generalpack. Thank you.